So we arrive at the airport and someone has come very kindly to pick us up. And he asks her, so how do the two of you know each other? Are you friends? Are you sisters? Are you colleagues? And this is actually a question that we get a lot. Because coming out of the closet and invisibility and overcoming that invisibility is a constant feature of life for LGBT people. The question is, when you have to take down a law and you are an electoral minority, you don't have the numbers to achieve change through the electoral process. If you take recourse to the courts to do this change, how do you change the mind of the adjudicators, of judges? The problem is that these adjudicators may simply not know you. And here you are making claims of citizenship to say that you are also full and equal citizens. In India, this question of changing the law arose with respect to Section 377 of the Indian Penal Code. Section 377 was a colonial era law introduced by the British in India in 1860. And it said that carnal intercourse against the order of nature would be punishable with up to life imprisonment. What that meant for LGBT people was that, one, their relationships were criminalized, two, they were thought to be unnatural, and three, even though this law had been introduced by the West, by British colonizers, and was an expression of Victorian-era morality, it had come to be understood as an expression, in fact, of conservative Indian social values. In the minds of the public, gay people were unnatural, were Western and not Indian, and were criminals. How do you move from this understanding to an understanding that you are, in fact, a citizen? And as a citizen, you belong in this country, and you should have full rights. Because what happens when you live with a criminal law is that, one, of course, you live with the fear of the police. The police interaction is the basic way in which many of us end up interacting with the state. But the second thing that happens is that a criminal law shuts down on your aspiration. Whether it's a question of where you're going to live, which city, do you stay in your hometown or do you have to move? What kind of job are you going to do? So do you choose a profession that you truly enjoy? Or do you choose a profession based on how accepting it will be of your sexuality? What kind of relationship can you aspire to? Can your relationships be open and accepted openly in society? All these factors can stem from a criminal law, even though it may not seem obvious. And so the difficulty becomes, how do you explain this? How do you explain living in fear of the police? And how do you explain living without aspiration to someone who may have, a complete misconception of who you are, and B, who may have no reference point, who may actually not see you, for whom you and your community are in fact invisible? In the challenge to Section 377 in India, the way the case came up was that in 2009, we had a high court which said that the law was bad and unconstitutional, and at that time, Suresh Kumar Kaushal, who was an astrologer and had actually nothing to do with Section 377, went to the Supreme Court, which is the highest court in India, and said that this law had been, the case below, had been wrongly decided, that Section 377 should remain on the statute books and was a good law. At that time, to oppose Kaushal, a number of people came forward. So you had parents of LGBT people, you had teachers, you had mental health professionals, you even had a member of parliament. And all of them talked about how Section 377 had affected their students, their patients, or their children. But what you didn't have till this point was actually gay people coming forward to talk about their own experiences in their own voices. The case was decided by the High Court in 2009. 2009, sometime a little while afterwards, Kaushal had gone to court. And in 2011 or 2012, when the case was being heard by the Supreme Court, one of the judges, Justice Singhvi, asked the lawyer for the government if he knew any gay people. So you have a case which has been pending almost for 10 years at this point, and the judge can still ask this question. The lawyer for the government said that he did not, in fact. And of course, the courtroom at this point was full of LGBT people, LGBT lawyers, but there was complete silence. I was a lawyer for the teachers at this point, and needless to say, we lost this case. In fact, we lost with language which was very hurtful for LGBT people. The court said that gay people in India were a minuscule minority and that they had so-called rights. It was a moment of great shock and depression, I believe, for the LGBT community in India. So I, along with a group of lawyers at this time, went back to the drawing board. And when we thought about what was the biggest gap in our strategy before this, it was clear that the public and the courts did not know, in fact, who LGBT people were. And you can imagine that at this point, gay people were not keen to go to court. With the Supreme Court that had just said that we were, in fact, criminals, and that Section 377 was a good law. But there were five LGBT people who stepped forward at this point, and I am completely in awe of their bravery and courage. Navtej Singh Johar was the lead petitioner. He is an Indian classical dancer. His partner, Sunil Mehra, a journalist. He and Navtej had been together for 23 years. Ritu Dalmia, a chef. Aman Nath, a hotelier. And Ayesha Kapoor, a businesswoman, stepped forward. And what was remarkable was that they shared their stories. Sunil had sat for the Indian Administrative Services exam, a very competitive exam, where he made it through to the first round, but he decided not to go ahead because he believed that he could not have an open relationship if he worked in the government while this law existed. Ayesha spoke of caring for her mother when her mother was ill with cancer and finally coming out to her mother at this time. During the course of the hearing, other gay people came forward as well. So Keshav Suri spoke about how his family had not accepted him when he came out to them initially. And of course that changed with time. And there was also a petition filed by 20 students and alum of the Indian Institutes of Technology. And for those of you who don't know, the Indian Institutes of Technology, the IITs, represent the pinnacle of educational aspiration in India. 1.2 million people sit for this exam every year, and around 10,000 qualify. So these 20 students belonged to an organization called Pravritti. Pravritti is 350 members strong, and it consists of students and alum of the IITs. And these 20 petitioners who came forward talked about the grit and the determination it had taken to sit for this incredibly competitive exam to get into this top STEM school. But they also spoke about the mental health issues, the depression, the harassment, and the bullying that they suffered because of 377, and the fact that they believed that they deserved to be full citizens of India. India is a young country. About 60% of our population is below the age of 30. And so here were these young people, their median age was 24. Unlike the first set of clients, Navtej and Sunil, Ayesha, Ritu, Aman, who had been in their late 40s to early 60s. And these young people said, we aspire. We're a young country, we're an aspirational country, and we want to have the jobs that we want to right here in India. We want to be with our partners. We want to live in the cities that we come from. We want these full lives of full citizenship. It is our common humanity. It is common stories of love and loss that unite us. During the arguments, my co-counsel, Menaka Guruswamy, compared the stories of Navtej and Sunil, of Aman, of Ritu, of Ayesha, with the stories of these IIT petitioners. and said that for older people, in some senses, their lives have gone by. But for our young clients, their lives deserve to be different. And the court responded to these stories. It said this time that LGBT people are full citizens of India. They are protected by the full gamut of rights and guarantees laid down under the Indian Constitution: equality, dignity, privacy. One of the judges, in fact, said that history owes an apology to LGBT people and their families. This is the power of our stories in law. Too often, and this is why I believe that this story is important, too often we come to believe, whether it is as women or as LGBT people, or as citizens who have gone through suffering, whether it is conflict, whether it is sectarian violence that faces my country today, that our stories are unimportant. Our stories get lost in the crowd. But in fact, I would like to remind you that your stories are the key to the bond that we share as citizens under a constitutional fabric. Your stories can change the law, they can change society, they can change the understanding of the Constitution, and therefore they can change your life. Thank you very much.